Dick Apper here. Today we're going to continue our look back at some of our favorite Pine Barrens episodes. We've had a lot of great guests on our program over the years. One of my favorites was Assemblyman Steven Englebright. We joined Englebright back in 2007 for a walk through the Hubbard County Park. Let's revisit that memorable trip through the Pine Barrens. Welcome to the Long Island Pine Barrens Society program. I'm Dick Amper.
And I'm Kathleen Nasta. And as you can see, we're not in the studio today. We're out in the Pine Barrens.
And at a very special place in the Pine Barrens. And to take us around there is a very special person. He's New York State Assemblyman Steven Englebright. And he's also a geologist and a naturalist on his own. Thanks for coming. Tell our viewers where we are and what's so special about the place.
We're in the rain.
And sure hope the rain keeps up. That way it won't come down. We're going to get a new writer. We are going to get a new writer for this program, I promise.
But the rain is recharging the aquifers, and in the Pine Barrens, one of the important things to do is follow the water. And the water that rains onto the surface of the Pine Barrens drains through the porous soils and eventually arrives at the shore, which is where we're also standing next to.
So we're getting the purest drinking water, recharging the drinking water aquifer, but there's also a part of this habitat that's benefiting as well, yes?
That's true. And this is the very special part of the Pine Barrens that is where the forest that characterizes the interior of Long Island meets the sea. This is scenery behind us here is a tidal salt marsh. So the rain that's coming down, of course, is part of what makes the Pine Barrens such a freshwater source. But eventually, because we are on an oceanic island, the freshwater passes under the soils that we're standing on and into tidewater. And the cycle continues because it's replenished by rain such as that which is coming down today. And the water that comes down pushes out, ultimately, the water that's come down many thousands of years ago, because it takes a while for this to happen, and the cycle is completed when the sun evaporates and makes rain happen again.
This so is where the this is where the Pine cycle. Barrens, but this is where the Pine Barrens meets the bay.
This is where the Pine Barrens meets the tidewater that surrounds, in this case, Flanders Bay, and we are standing actually in a county park, and one of the most beautiful of all of the county parks. This is Hubbard County Park. And Hubbard County Park is on the edge of the Pine Barrens and is part of the largest assemblage of Pine Barrens anywhere in the state.
When you say by assemblage, you mean that government has put together a program to get not just a parcel here, but a parcel someplace else, but a place where we've connected a whole bunch of them. We have a place that will be preserved the way it was for how many decades?
Well, for all practical purposes, you're looking at a 19th century landscape here, this is native Long Island. This is our natural history heritage, unspoiled and unblemished. And yes, we've put together an assemblage here of something approaching 15,000 acres. This is one of the largest places that you can walk and go get lost in the woods and have a wonderful
time. Still be in suburban Long Island.
Still be in suburban Long Island. And it's also very special because there are so very few places, because so many construction activities have occurred in the coastal zone. This is one of the very few places that you can actually see the vegetative transition between the uplands and the wetlands, such as these fringing marshes that are behind us here. These are tide water influenced twice daily by the tides.
So we're standing in the transition zone. Up here we would look for traditional Pine Barrens forest. Down there we're looking for a marine habitat. We're right where one turns into the other, yes?
That's exactly what we are in. And yet it's still Pine Barrens in the very real sense. For example, these cones, which are off of this tree, are of a variety called serotinous cones, meaning that they are closed even upon maturity. They do not shed their seeds unless they're burned. So These particular cones have not yet been burned. The seeds are still inside, and these trees, even to reproduce, require fire. So we have behind us water, we have all around us with the rain, water, and fire. Fire and water, and in this case, the fire defines the Pine Barrens. It's a fire climax ecosystem.
Explain that to our viewers.
What does that mean?
Well, that means that in this particular ecosystem, fire is the dominant force. Over time, the plants and animals have adapted to it. Their reproductive cycles and their strategies for reproduction have to take into account fire. Natural selection has over time caused cones to remain closed to protect the seeds from fire. That's why these cones are closed. And so much so are they dependent now or reacting to fire that they now require fire to melt the resin and allow the seeds to come out after the fire passes.
So where does the fire come from that is so necessary for the reproduction cycle?
Today, of course, there are accidental fires. And in some cases, when the forest gets too thick with fuel, needles, pine needles, we actually have specialists who come in and work with government to do prescribed burns. And we actually do burns in the Pine Barrens in some places in order to reduce the leaf litter that is so fire prone during a drought period in the summer usually. And we burn that away on purpose to prevent an accidental fire such as the Sunrise fires that you may recall a few years ago drew national attention. Mm-hmm. The fire was so hot and fast and out of control in part because no controlled or prescribed burns had been done.
So the prescribed burns are set at a cycle similar to what you would see in nature?
That's the idea, yes. Okay. And so this entire ecosystem basically has its biological clock reset by periodic wildfires. And of course, before we had such things as roads, the fires that a lightning strike would usually start in pre-colonial time, there would be a lightning strike. And the fire, we have actually records of fires that have burned from Southampton all the way to Smithtown, taking more than 2 weeks to do that. In our colonial records, we have records of very large fires. So before we have paved roads and interruptions by other human-built structures, the fires really dominated a very large part of coastal Long Island. And the Pine Barrens habitat and the vegetation of the Pine Barrens is a very ancient one. These species are not measured in terms of age by just a few hundred years. These are millions of years old. This is a very ancient habitat. Probably many of these plant species evolved when there were still dinosaurs in North America. And so we're really looking at a very ancient habitat that has for hundreds of millions of years grown toward what you see here today, or at least tens of millions of years, perhaps on the scale of about 100 million total years.
Show us some of these things close up. What are we looking at here?
Well, this is pitch pine, Pinus rigida. Pitch pine is the dominant conifer in the Pine Barrens. And by the way, notice this darker color here. And notice I have charcoal when I rub it. This is a fire. This is evidence of a fire having come through here and caused the outer bark to basically become charred. But this tree is adapted for fire in several ways. I've already mentioned that its reproductive strategy.
The serotonous cones.
The serotonous cones is an evidence of adaption to fire, but so is the bark, this very thick, scaly bark.
It's like an armor.
It's an armor. Exactly right, Dick. And what happens is that the fire hopefully will not penetrate into the core of the tree. Usually the fires pass as sort of a wave across the land. They'll scar and then move on. They'll melt the resin and the fire will move on and the seeds will come out on the still smoldering but now no longer open flame earth. And other things that these trees can do, they actually have what's referred to as a basal notch. If we were to dig the entire tree out of the ground, we would see that there's a portion of the main root that actually is off to one side. so that if the fire gets hot enough so that it destroys the main trunk, it'll re-sprout and regrow from the basal notch that's off to the side. This isn't something that evolved quickly. These are adaptive strategies to the sandy eastern edge of North America, the coastal plain, geological province of North America. Our particular species of great interest, of course, is Pinus rigida, the pitch pine, and it is very interesting in its own right. But there's a whole host of other plants in here. And what I find of great interest, Dick, behind us here, we see the salt marsh. We have evidence of fire, and here is a marsh. Obviously, with a wetland that close, the fire would have stopped. The fire that made these...
You're playing forest detective. You can actually say, this is the way the fire
came.
This is
the direction
of the fire. It came from here.
Yeah, the fire burned this side of the tree. The other side is not charred. And no doubt, the fire died when it hit the wetlands behind us. It was quenched by the wet soils of the marsh. This is also special for another conifer, though. And I want to mention the other conifer. In addition to pitch pine, you'll see these triangular-shaped conifers behind us. These are Atlantic white cedar. And Atlantic white cedar is a very rare plant. The cedar was so terrific for making house shingles that it was pretty much harvested almost to extinction on Long Island by the colonial settlers.
Because it handles weather as well as it does.
And it weathers beautifully. It's great for fence posts. So it was cut heavily. But it was rare to begin with. It had a narrow range. And in this forest transition, you'll actually see the pitch pines are in the uplands. And between here and the marsh, you see a narrow band where the Atlantic white cedars come in. They exist where the water is still fresh, but beginning to be brackish, meaning it has some salt in it. And they exist in that narrow brackish to fresh boundary. That is the boundary between where the fresh water oozes out of the Pine Barren soils and enters into the ocean. That's salt water, that's ocean. This is uplands.
This is fresh.
And the boundary between the two is really defined by this
whole band.
Particular band of conifers here.
Uh-huh.
And it's part of what makes this park so special. It's a rarity today, a real museum piece to be able to see this vegetative transition, and here in Hubbard Park, it's pristine.
So pitch pine is not the only conifer that we're looking at, right?
No.
So
we're looking at two conifers and a whole host of other plants that really, to the eye of a plant detective, tell a story about this place. One of the things that's very interesting is that the typical shrub layer of the Pine Barrens, not the trees, but the shrub layer of the Pine Barrens is very different here than what you would normally expect. For example, there's catbriar or greenbriar in some abundance here, which is unusual because this is a fire area and that particular plant perishes in fire. So why is it here? And where is the scrub oak? I don't see any of the second.
That's
really
the second major.
Second major plant, which is Quercus alyssifolia. That particular plant is an oak. It's missing. Why? And you start to see other things as well, and you say, there's blueberries here, and over by the marsh, there's marsh elder. I've never seen marsh elder intergrowing with blueberries before, but there, you see it here.
Now, wait a minute, because you're an assemblyman, does that make that marsh elder statesman?
I didn't say much elder, I said marsh elder.
Okay.
But what the land use history here is that this was an area that was settled early and they used it for grazing. So they had sheep and cattle in here and they liked to eat oaks. And over time, they ate all of the acorns. And then the fire came through and there were no acorns left. And so the sheep in particular are responsible for the absence of the scrub oak. And the birds are responsible for the presence of dropping seeds here as they fly through these woods to constantly bring in the catbriar or the greenbrier. So the greenbrier would never have had a foothold here if it wasn't for the fact that the oaks are gone, that the scrub oak is missing, and that's a result of the historic use of this as a pasture. And it was a nice place for a pasture because the natural boundary, the animals would get their feet wet and back off, so they didn't have to build a fence here. This was this row of cedars, Kathleen, is really an invisible boundary. And so the animals stayed on this side of that tree boundary.
So this park is pretty much the only one that you're aware of that has that type of history?
It's the one where you see it best. And I'm sure that this scenario that I've just described was common in many other sites. Most of those sites, though, are not preserved as parkland. And most of our coastal boundary has been intensively developed. This is why this is such a rare place. Otherwise, if this had not wisely been set aside by county government with the help of the state as a park 30 years ago or so, this would have also turned into a condominium complex. Mm.
So we've got sheep and the men who brought them there and the birds who dropped the seeds and the fire. What we try to establish all the time when we're doing environmental programs is the interreaction of just so many different elements. It's almost arrogant of people to think that we can really recreate any of this. All of these elements occur naturally and they all impact some other portion of the natural world. And here's sort of almost a museum at which you can see this at work.
This is a museum piece. This park is one of my favorite parks anywhere, and it is one of the places where you can see this interaction, as Dick has indicated, between natural forces and human-inspired forces. And there's a story, and the story basically tells those who have the ability to see into it the history of Long Island. And we haven't mentioned the Aboriginal people who lived here, but they too prospered along the shore edge and lived along the shore edge. And in many cases, cleared areas that the colonials prized because they didn't have to do the clearing in their first year of settlement. There was already a clearing in the woods, and they would occupy where Indians had previously been for thousands of years. So the interplay between humans and nature is very interesting and tells the story of ourselves, really. And we see it best in these extraordinary parks. Hubbard Park is actually named after the Hubbard family, which settled this area. And there's actually a cemetery in this park that you can see the Hubbard family is still here. Altogether, there's a lot of poetry in this place if you take the time to read it.
So can you show us the marine portion of this?
Kathleen, I would be delighted.
Great.
Let's take a look.
Come on, everybody, let's go. The Long Island Pine Barrens. Let's protect them. Hey, we're talking again with New York State Assemblyman Steve Englebright at Hubbard County Park in the Pine Barrens.
And we're down at the water's edge. Assemblyman, can you tell our viewers exactly where we are and why we're here?
We're on a spit of sand where the Flanders portion of the Great Peconic Bay brushes against the Pine Barrens. Behind us, you see the pine forest come down to the marsh, and we're on a sliver of sand that lies between the water and the marsh. So we're really far out as far as the Pine Barrens is concerned. We're literally at the edge. But what's so very fascinating about this is that even though the pine trees are a quarter of a mile from us here, and the fringe of Atlantic white cedars that is growing, that defines the boundary between the Pine Barrens and the marine realm, is a quarter of a mile away.
Right.
We're standing and looking at a fossil of Atlantic white cedar. These,
the same trees we saw up there,
are the same trees. Only here,
so these little,
and as you can see, they're actually out in the water of the salt water.
And out there, they're under the water.
So
what happened then?
They didn't hike down here.
They didn't hike here. They're in living position. You can actually see the runners of the roots. They actually grew here. But how could that be? Because obviously Atlantic white cedar doesn't thrive. This isn't Florida. This isn't mangroves. We don't have any trees at this latitude on eastern North America that grows in the tidewater.
So a long time ago, something happened. And
what we're really looking at is evidence of where the Atlantic white cedar boundary of the Pine Barrens used to be. And sea level has come up.
This is not global warming.
Yeah, well, it's the same process. It is global warming, but it's not induced by the Industrial Revolution.
Gotcha.
We're looking at global warming since the last glacier. So just to recreate what really has happened here, 21,000 years ago, the glacier was on Long Island. It laid down a lot of sand. That sand is what the Pine Barrens is growing in. And then as the glacier melted back, it was such a big glacier, it covered the northern quarter of the globe. As it melted, it caused sea level to rise 300 feet worldwide.
Wow.
Almost 400 feet worldwide. That is the great flood that is described in the Bible, the biblical flood. Here in Hubbard Park, we see the biological evidence that, in fact, that flood drowned and killed these living trees of Atlantic white cedar, which again are the boundary of the Pine Barrens. And so some of these trees, this happens to be Atlantic white cedar, but as you walk along this stretch of beach, some of these trees are actually pitch pine, still in rooted in living position, but now killed by the rise of sea level, and the salt itself of the water of the sea has killed these plants.
Now, why wouldn't this have rotted away by now in all those
It is years? Still here in part because it really isn't very tasty, because it has natural resins that make it really not very delicious for bacteria.
Okay.
And in this case, for the shipworm, which likes to eat wood. So it survives in part because it is cedar and has this aromatic context to its tissue. And so it's still here. How old is this?
Yeah.
I'm going to guess that we're looking at something that's on the scale of between 1 and 3,000 years old. So this is a fossil tree. And this is a ghost forest. One of a very few ghost forests in the Northeast. Here's another tree. Here's another. And these are ghosts of what was once a living forest that defined the boundary of the Pine Barrens at a time when sea level was perhaps anywhere from 5 to 15 feet lower. It's pretty great stuff. But there's a real secret here. There is a secret here, beyond this, even beyond the ghost forest.
Are you going to tell us a secret?
Well, there's several secrets, but there's one in particular. And it's found in the rocks on the beach. Some of these rocks are actually to a detective of nature able to tell the story of why the Pine Barrens is here. So what we're really looking at with this very dark rock, and I have three of them that I've just picked up right here on the beach, this is basalt. Now basalt is an igneous rock, meaning that it was molten and flowed out of a fissure deep in the earth. It cooled quickly at the surface. Rocks like this are characteristic of the tearing apart of a continent and the creation of a new ocean. When this was created, the Atlantic Ocean didn't exist. This was what happened when Europe and Africa were torn apart from what is now North and South America. This oozed up as a liquid from the deep core of the earth, came up and quenched at the surface, and the valley that was the rift, or the tear, the so-called Rift Valley, today we call it the Great Connecticut Valley. And this cooled first. This tells us that there's a source. The glacier brought this here from someplace to the north. And guess what? If you look on a map, the Great Connecticut Valley is immediately to the north. And in that rift valley is the only place in all of Connecticut, in all of southern New England, if you will, that you find these rocks. And this is a coarse sandstone. If you were to take a hammer and crush it, it would look just like the soils of the Pine Barrens. So let's recreate what happened here. We had an ancient rift valley that, once the rift was created during Triassic times, there were dinosaurs running around. And we're back in time about something on the scale of about 160 to 200 million years ago. And erosion took place and washed off of the edges of the rift valley and down into the valley itself, sand, and the sand coalesced into this sandstone. Then the glacier came along, oh, very recently, only about a million years ago, were the first of the four glacial stages here in eastern North America. And the glacier crushed this relatively soft rock. The rest of southern New England is hard, crystalline bedrock. But this stuff is soft, and the glacier freezing and thawing and rubbing rocks into this that were frozen into the glacier crushed it into the sand that was so abundant in the glacier that when it reached here and the melting water spilled southward and created a great plain, we now call it Long Island, that sand-rich plain is made of this rock from the Great Connecticut Valley, crushed. And the abundance of sand was so much because the sandstone valley of ancient times, of Triassic time, was to the north. So there's a symmetry. The secret of the Pine Barrens is that it's really another kind of ghost. It's a reflection, geologically, of the bedrock of Connecticut. Don't you see?
That's great.
The bedrock of Connecticut north of the Pine Barrens is sandstone, and the sand of the Pine Barrens that supports this wonderful array
the sand
of
from that
plants
stone.
Is from that sandstone valley that itself was created in the process of opening the Atlantic Ocean and creating the separateness between the continents that we have on the global map today.
This happened without any help from the Pine Barrens Society.
That's right.
I'm not sure. I think you were there with the Tyrannosaurus.
I'm not as old as I am.
We got you back for the comment before.
Speaking of old things, let me just point out, here where this ancient forest meets the sea, the oldest ecosystem on Earth is the ocean. And there are lots of animals that we tend to take for granted, but when you look in the fossil record, these are ancient lineages, things that you find along the shore that are, you know, like the blue mussel and the quahog and the razor clam, and yes, the Limulus polyphemus, as my good
it's
friend.
It's easy for you to say.
These are all ancient lineages that are more than 100 million, approaching, in the case of the horseshoe crab, 250 million years of Earth time. So when you come and you come to Hubbard Park, or you go into the Pine Barrens, particularly here where the Pine Barrens meets the sea, you're really looking at, sort of in a nutshell, the history of the Earth. And the lineages of the ancient creatures, both the plants and animals that are here, predate and give us a sense, predate our species by a long time. And if you look at it within that context, it's quite humbling. These are really wonderful creatures. They deserve our respect. And in these parks, they have a chance to be continued and for their lineages to live on.
We've been talking to New York State Assemblyman Steve Englebright. We're at Hubbard County Park in the Pine Barrens. I'm Dick Amper.
And I'm Kathleen Nasta.
Be with us.
See you soon.